been an important community presence and commercial leader in the Pioneer Valley. With convenient full banking services in Westfield, West Springfield, East Longmeadow, Agawam, Feeding Hills, Springfield, Southwick, as well as Enfield and Granby, Connecticut, visit us on the web at westfieldbank.org.
It's actually not that loud.
Oh, okay, good. Well, actually, the big fan is on.
it's not that loud. It's farther away from you than it normally is.
No, I know it is.
You got out by the window, I think, or something, right?
Yes, I did. So, good morning, everyone. JPEG Luca here. Pete Cole's on the other side of the board. It's a beautiful, beautiful, cool...
Opened the windows last night.
Yeah.
Gave the air conditioner a rest.
Yep, absolutely did. It woke up to a beautiful, cool morning, a beautiful ride in. Walked into the studios this morning to almost 90 degrees.
Yes.
So
on that front, I talked to the air conditioner guys. They found a slight problem with the unit. And then I talked to the guy that does the programming for the thermostats. And he says that it goes into night mode, which it's supposed to do. And then it doesn't ever comes out. So that's why it's 85 when we get here in the morning. By mid-afternoon, it's usually about 75 degrees in here. So I don't know. But they're working on it. So they're continuing to work on it and figure out
what the deal is. So here's the problem with today's air conditioning systems. It used to be just an air conditioner. Well, no, it used to be just a fan. When you need to cool off, you turn on the fan.
Yes.
All right. Now, then we evolved into air conditioning. So now... All right, you had to have a fancy air conditioner. And granted, it was certainly better, although I can remember growing up, I never had air conditioning, but my neighbor did. You know, they were the affluent neighbors because they had this.
Yeah, the AC, and they probably had the first electric refrigerator.
Oh, yeah, that was it. Yeah, I still had an icebox. And it's so they had this giant, giant air conditioner in the wall. They cut a hole in the wall.
We had one of those
wall.
When I was a kid, yep.
Yeah. And so that was a cool thing. On the hot days, we'd all go over and hang out in front of that air conditioner. See, but now the problem today is you can't go to Home Depot and buy a new air conditioner.
Sure you can.
Not for
a place like this.
But. Right. So you get a place like this, you got to figure out first, does the air conditioner work? Then you got to call the IT people to find out if the thermostats are programmed correctly, and if they're not, you got to call the programmers to come over and program the thermostats. But then if they don't do it right, you got to work with them. And
well, we have thermostat programmers in the city, so they were all trained by Siemens how to do that. But it's when the thermostats don't talk to the unit, things like that.
Oh, then you need a network engineer because the networks are not work. So. You need way too many people to fix this problem, and it's all a project management thing. You got to bring all these people together in the right place at the right time.
That happened years ago. That won't happen again. This is a business. These things happen once, and then everybody. I do know that the guy that does the programming was here with the text from the HVAC contractor yesterday. He was working with them yesterday, so. They're dialed in now. Now we just got to get it right.
And of course, you've got to have 5 Zoom meetings in order to, you know, make sure everybody's on the same page.
Oh no, these guys are just here working on it.
Oh, okay.
Because they understand, they do get the fact that this equipment A needs to stay on, and B needs to keep relatively cool. So they understand those issues, and they're work. I mean, I'll give them credit; they're working on it. It may get to the point where I need to buy an air conditioner just for this room.
Well, not that room. I want it for this room.
No, this is more important.
Just because you're in it?
No, because the equipment's in it. They don't give a crap about me.
Yeah.
They could care less about me.
I learned that a long time ago when I was working in the computer rooms, the mainframe computer rooms of the Aetnas and the Hartford Insurance Group places down in Hartford. They didn't care about the people. But the computer sure had to stay cold. So on those
right.
hot summer days, that's where you wanted to work, is in the computer room.
And I'd be wearing shorts today, absent of the fact that I have to go to City Hall for a flag-raising event today and help Kenny set up. So,
Can't wear shorts at City Hall?
It's not good when you're working.
Oh. Well, okay.
Plus, I don't have great legs, Jay. You don't want to see that.
I have great legs.
If I was here just working in here by myself, or, you know, with the regular crew or whatever, I'd be wearing shorts because it's warm. But, you know, you gotta look the part, I guess, you know. At least a little.
Well, all right. For the record, no, I don't have great legs. That's why you rarely see me in shorts as well.
It's been so warm in here in the mornings. It's like, you know what? I'm just going to wear shorts. Yeah. And I'm far more comfortable that way because it's been hot.
All right. So we told you all of that story to tell you this story. That's why there's noise in the background. I got the big fan on. So.
We got to catch up once in a while.
Hey, who do we have coming in this weekend for?
Hold on. Let me fire up the old telephone.
Yeah. I think we have something on Sunday.
We have two on Sunday.
Two on Sunday?
Yes.
Whoa. I didn't know that.
We moved the one from Saturday to Sunday because I have a wedding to go to.
Is it a cattywampus? Never cattywampus.
No. At 4 o'clock, we have a band called From Logan to Lima.
Okay.
No idea what that is. And then at 6 o'clock, we have a act called Wildcat O'Halloran.
We got to learn how to pronounce that before
Wildcat
Sunday.
O'Halloran.
Okay, good. That sounds like a good Irish band, don't it?
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah.
And then we kind of wrap up our season with a live show next Friday. We're going to be we can't do the fireworks, I guess, this year. I guess they gave it a shot on the drive-in side. We couldn't pull it together fast enough. But we are going to have music for you on the 4th of July, and we're going to bring in traditional Corey and the Knightsmen from 6 to 7:30-ish. They can go as long as up till 8 o'clock, so we give them between an hour and a half and 2 hours. And then at 8 o'clock until 9:30 or 10-ish, we'll do Trailer Trash. And then we're going to run the 350 fireworks from last year.
That'd be kind of cool because that was, as I recall...
It was a great show.
That was one of the best shows we've had here in town in my memory.
Yeah.
Certainly, it was just a lot of fun, a lot of excitement, a lot of people around. And anyway, long story short, it's going to be...
So we will have our Independence Day celebration on July 3rd. Next Friday, and it's going to be a wild show, and we got everybody's permission to do everything, and we'll be in good shape, and everybody will be indoors, so we can keep them relatively cool, and we don't have to worry about the weather in case there's a thunderstorm or something like that.
That would be a good thing.
And we're going to have a little picnic for the people that are coming in to donate their time, because they really are donating their time.
Yeah, everybody's doing this on our own on our own time, and, well, there's, like, nothing else to do this summer. So,
well, you got shows going to start coming up, right? You got a truck show or something? Or is that off again?
It's a whole lot of tentative, and we'll get to that in a minute. Wanted to thank everybody that was at the drive-in last Saturday night.
Drive-in and movie.
That was a good time. It was a family drive-in movie. It was all surrounding the Westfield Boys and Girls Club. Thanks to Bo Sullivan, to Bill Parks, and all of the crew at the Boys and Girls Club for helping to put this thing together. Needed a handful of volunteers, and of course we brought a big screen in, and I'll tell you what, I didn't think it was going to be big enough, but we had over 100 cars there, and this almost 40-foot wide screen was just perfect. You felt like to me, it was nostalgic because you felt like you were back as a kid in a big movie. To most of the people in the audience,
it was new.
They'd never been to anything like that.
And the funny thing is there's one within driving distance of us. There's a couple, actually.
Well, there is. There's Northfield. There's also a couple in Connecticut. And
right.
Mansfield, and there's one down in Barkhamsted, too, and Southington. So they're still around, and it's nice to see they're getting a little resurgence. So that's really a cool thing.
Northfield's 71 years this year.
And it just changed ownership. They've got some new people have come in and they're really trying to put a little bit of new energy behind it. So that's a cool thing.
Oh, so this week, I love this. They had a problem getting Avengers Endgame, I guess. So here's their lineup. On Friday, 6/26, they're going to be showing a classic at 8:45. Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
That's not old enough to be a classic.
It is.
And I'll talk about classics in a minute, but that's not old enough to be a classic.
All right, so I don't get this. 9 and 12:15, Garth Brooks. On Saturday, 6/26.
Oh, yes. That's
27th.
It's a live Garth Brooks concert. It's his real concert.
So 9 p.m. and then we're going to repeat it at 12:15 a.m., I guess?
Yep. And that concert is being broadcast live, well, at least the 9 o'clock one, all across the country, to drive-ins all across the country.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, it is. And now, to carry that further forward.
Oh, I wish I could go up for that one.
We're going to try and do our own drive-in concert. We've done the drive-in theater for movies over at the Boys and Girls Club. Now, let's take that a step further. What if we make it a concert? What if we put a stage there and we have a live band on stage with, you know, well, we're going to do we're talking about doing an afternoon show and an evening show. And this thing could really take off. Probably is going to happen in late August. I can't say the artist yet because I don't know. That's why I can't say. We just haven't signed anything yet for him. We've got two possibilities. And it's all about availability, and you know, the artists are itching to do this. So I think you'll be impressed. It's also going to be a benefit for the Boys and Girls Club here of Westfield. I talking with Bill Parks last night, and a shout out to all of my friends in Kiwanis. We all got together for our first properly socially distanced meeting under a giant tent. Last night, and Bill Parks was there, and we talked briefly about this. He's all in, and we're going to try and make this happen. So the next movie at Behind the Boys and Girls Club is August 15th. I believe that's a Saturday. It should be the third Saturday in August. And then in the week or two following that, it's going to be before the end of August, we're going to put a concert on over there. So stay tuned for more information on that. Now, back to this classic movie thing. Classic movie's got to be a whole lot older than Ferris Bueller. Now, don't get me wrong. That was a good movie.
That's considered a classic to a lot of people.
Well, people that aren't as old as me, perhaps.
Because it has stood the test of time.
that it has.
As much as Casablanca.
The Parade, Casablanca is a classic movie.
But that's also stood the test of time.
It has, yes.
If they reboot Ferris Bueller, I will go out on the street and protest. rebooted everything else.
Yeah, well, booted out of the. Yeah, never mind. But the Ferris Bueller, my favorite scene in that is the one in the parade when they're doing Twist and Shout. That's by far. There were some really great scenes, but that's one of my favorites. Classic movies. This we're doing our. We've already done one of the first drive-ins here in Westfield in the area. But also, got a shout out to Joe Deedy. He's kind of taken the ball and running with it down in Southwick. He's building a portable drive-in, which is basically, you got to love him for this because it's something I would have done. He's putting a screen on the side of a truck, a big truck. There's a just rolling screen. So where do you want the drive-in?
Yeah,
today?
He mentioned me about that. I got to call him today. He wants to talk about that. He wants me to do a video to promote it or something. I don't know. You got to understand Joe. Joe goes, hey, I got this idea, and I need your help getting this thing done. And you know, I says, Joe, we can't do this over text message. It just doesn't. You and I, we communicate better when we talk. All right, yeah, we'll talk tomorrow. Yeah, we'll talk tomorrow.
But he's got the idea, and he's going to run with this thing. And really, hats off to Joe, because he's just like I am. All right, here it is. What do we got to do to get it? What do I need to buy? Let's make it happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, and he'll somehow he'll make this happen. And, you know, and I certainly my hat's off to him and my hands out, or my not my hands out, because I don't need anything from him, but I'm offering. What do you need? Yeah. So my hands up. Saying, hey, what do you need, Joe? And we're going to help him make this happen. Now, classic movies. This is going back to class. He wants to do things, okay, he wants to do these in various different places. He wants to go out to the racetrack and over the motocross track. Do one over there, but he wants to bring classic cars in, and he wants to do American Graffiti. That's classic.
That's a classic, yep.
Then he wants to go over to by the lakes, by the Congamon. And he wants to run The Creature from the Black Lagoon.
That's great.
All right. So now, that's great. That's classic.
That's in the public domain, too, I think.
It's not only is it classic, but it is classic drive-in B-movie schlock. You just can't get any cheesier than The Creature from the Black Lagoon. And there's talk that he wants to run the original Jaws, too. You know, and now, wouldn't that be cool if he aimed the screen towards the water and you had to be on a boat and then...
The Creature from the Black Lagoon is in the public domain, so he can run that without paying any rights fees.
There you go. So these
just checked.
Yeah, so, but have this happen, and then we got to have somebody who plays the Creature from the Black Lagoon come up out of the water. You know, there's so many things you can do with this.
Hey, when the summer's over, would you be interested in hosting a wraparound show? It's been done at other public accesses, but I want to revive it.
Wrap around?
Drive-in schlock theater.
Oh, is that like Mystery Theater 3000 kind of thing?
No. But yeah, a little. You run public domain movies, and you run them late night, and there's some two guys that did it around here for years, and I don't know what happened to them. They dropped off.
Oh, I do remember that.
Strange Movies and yes. The ghouls, the two ghouls.
It was about the time that Mystery Science Theater 3000 was around.
They did it up until about 2 or 3 years ago, and then they dropped off the face of the earth.
Yeah.
So I want to replace that and do it out of here. I think we could do it. We have a green screen, so I could put you in a drive-in every week.
That would be kind of fun. Well,
we could go to a drive-in. Palmer or Northfield would probably let it. You know, the old Palmer drive-in now is a sand quarry, and some of the stuff is still up, and it's like an abandoned drive-in.
You got to do it in front of the screen. You know, it's kind of sad. There's a couple places I had when I'm heading down to Providence, Rhode Island. I think it's 146. Heading south of Worcester.
Yeah,
there's
the Edgemere.
There's a couple of
drive-ins. Edgemere. I think it's called
there.
Edgemere.
I don't think they're running anymore, but it's kind of sad to see the old broken down marquee.
Can we get in there? You think we could go shoot? We could shoot a season's worth of wraparounds in an afternoon.
I'll tell you what, I'd rather do Northfield. They're nearby, and we can give them a little bit of publicity from here.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically you shoot an intro to the movie. And you shoot an outro to the movie, and that's it. And you credits, and that's it. So we need to look up. I'll start working on that later on in the summer. We'll get a season's worth of public domain movies.
Yeah, get a phone call up to those guys. Yeah, I mean that'd be a good off season promotion for them, just to have their name show up in the credits. You know. So, see, we're already looking forward to what are we going to do this winter when we still can't go anywhere. My goodness, I hope this finally does calm down. Let's not talk about it. You're seeing it on the news every damn day. Let's go to break, and then we're going to come back with a little bit of JP's Golden Age of Radio. We're going to come back with some comedy. I don't know what, because Pete hasn't picked it yet. We'll be back right after this.
Hold on, let me get something loaded up. I was expecting to go right to. I had Bing Crosby, the Bing Crosby Show with Bob Hope. Why don't we go right into that?
That sounds pretty darn good.
All right, let's just roll into that bad boy. JP's Golden Age of Radio is now.
Support for the community programming of
Hello? It's just that deck that's not working.
Okay, so I walk into the control room and it's very quiet, and I'm going, "Is that playing?"
I don't know why the deck.
That's right. While you work on that, we're going to talk about more things coming up. So we do have a truck show in Brimfield, and it's a giant truck show. This is professional drivers. Who, you know, you'll see these driving along the highway. They're really beautiful trucks.
And okay, now it's
now
working.
You've got it. But that's going to happen too.
Well, I don't know why that was weird. Like, I have no idea why that one deck's not playing.
Don't explain that why you don't know why. We'll just talk about the truck show for a minute. Let me finish that.
Yeah, that's fine.
And then we'll run with this.
Okay.
All right. Truck show coming up in Brimfield at the Brimfield Winery. That's going to happen. It looks like July 30th. And August 1st. It's going to be a two-day show out there. Huge thing, and they're beautiful trucks. They're supposed to have hundreds of these things out there, and it's a national thing that we're doing, and I'm helping out with PA throughout the facility. But I'm really excited about this. We were talking about it. It's on again, off again. It's all about the town feeling safe. So that's still just look at search truck show in Brimfield, and you'll find more about it there. This is JPEG Luca. Pete Coles is in the control room on the other side of the board.
Now
and
that it's working,
is JP's Golden Age of Radio.
Chesterfield. Howdy folks, a big hello. We're here to start the Cosby Show. Before you do another thing, just take this tip from Brother Bing.
Sound off.
For Chesterfield.
Sound off.
For Chesterfield.
Tie a pack of Chesterfields.
Do it.
Today.
Chesterfield, produced and transcribed in Fort Ord, California, with John Scott Trotter and his orchestra, Judd Collins of the Bears, and Bing's guests, Miss Monica Lewis and Mr. Bob Hope. And now, from the Army Training Center at Fort Ord, here is a man whose only worry about the draft is that he stiffens up when he stands in one, Bing Crosby.
Hey, just a minute there, Ken. You don't have to single me out as the only one who's wide open to an attack of rheumatism.
Yeah.
I want to tell you something, boy. Nearly everybody out here in sun-drenched California's turned a little blue lately.
Sun-drenched?
A little bit grizzly.
California certainly had a chilly winter.
But really, in this cold weather, Ken, I want to tell you, I've gone the full route in the underwear department.
You mean to say you're wearing long underwear?
In my set, we refer to them as blizzard bloomers.
That's funny. In our group, they're known as tummy ticklers.
Mine tickle all over.
Oh, do you itch?
They itch, I scratch.
I pass.
You pass.
You know, Bing, since you've been honest with me, I think there's a confession I should make.
Oh, Ken, you don't mean
it. Yes, Bing. I'm wearing longies, too.
Oh, well, it's too bad this isn't an air base here. We both could have landed with our flaps down. Oh.
Well, I know it must be awfully chilly where you're living over in Pebble Beach, isn't it?
Is it? Mm. Boy, Bob Hope is my house guest, you know, and every night we've been sleeping with three extra quilts on our bed.
On your bed?
Yeah.
Well, for goodness sake, why do you and Bob have to sleep in the same bed?
Kid's afraid to be alone in the dark, you know. But I want to tell you something else, and this is really a fact.
What's that?
This is honest. Fella walks in his sleep, you know, Hope.
Bob?
Yeah.
What makes him walk in his sleep?
Too cheap to take a taxi, I guess.
Sleepwalking is dangerous.
Oh, honestly, I think he was just faking.
Think so?
Sure. He was carrying a lantern. And
lantern?
Yeah. See, I live right there on the golf course, Ken. I think he was on a nocturnal hunt for lost golf balls. Picking an old Dunlop out there.
Bob wouldn't
flight.
Do that.
I don't know. When he came back to bed, he felt awful lumpy. And another thing, Ken, I don't like to really condemn a fella before he's caught, you know, red-handed. You
shouldn't do that, no.
But I think, I don't want this brooded around, but I think only reason he came up to visit me is to nab the silverware and everything else that's loose around the house.
No, Bing, that's a pretty strong statement. You talk as though Bob were a regular burglar.
Well, all I know is he arrived at my place with four suitcases, three of them empty. What do you think?
What was in the fourth one?
A floor plan of my house. Also a flashlight, a blackjack, a Jim Inn, and a Dick Tracy comic book. But I must be carefree. We've got to go on about the impending heist. Get on with the opening selection here, which, according to the paper, is a song called Undecided. John Scott, I'm ready if you are.
First you say you do, and then you don't. And then you say you will, and then you won't. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do? Oh, now you want to play, and then it's no. And when you say you stay, that's when you go. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do? I've been sitting on a fence, and it doesn't make much sense, 'cause you keep me in suspense, and you know it. Then you promise to return. When you don't, I really burn. Well, I guess I'll never learn, and I show it. If you got a heart and if you're kind, then don't keep us apart, make up your mind. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do?
I've been sitting on a fence, and it doesn't make much sense, 'cause you keep me in suspense, and you know it. Bible advises up, then you promise to return. When you don't, I really burn. Well, I guess I'll never learn, and I show it.
If you've got a heart and if you're kind, don't keep us apart, make up your mind. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do?
'Cause first you say you do, and then you say you don't, and then you say you will, and then you say you won't. You're undecided now, so what are you gonna do?
Cigarette that's milder, tastes better, and leaves no unpleasant aftertaste, change to Chesterfield's today. Yes, sir. Enjoy your smoking with Chesterfield Mildness Plus, no unpleasant aftertaste.
Chesterfield Mildness has been confirmed by 1,562 prominent tobacco growers. No unpleasant aftertaste has been confirmed by a world-famous research organization. They reported, of all brands tested, only Chesterfield leaves no unpleasant aftertaste.
Yep, Chesterfield Mildness Plus no unpleasant aftertaste. That's smoking pleasure all the way. Try a pack of Chesterfields today, or even better, get a carton, as old Godfrey tells you to do. Enjoy your smoking and sound off for Chesterfields. Now, fellas, I'd like to have you all meet one of our loveliest young singing stars. Very beautiful, very talented, Monica Lewis.
Thank you, Bing.
Monica, it's really nice that you could come up here tonight. What are you going to sing for us tonight, these strong, healthy young fellas, Monica?
Well, I thought I might do How Am I to Know from the new MGM picture, Pandora and the Flying Dutchman.
Oh, Pandora and the Flying Dutchman, huh? I wonder if he comes in with his flaps up or down. I must...
No.
You don't know about that, huh?
No, but it stars James Mason and Ava Gardner.
Oh, fine. This is a lovely song. Let's have it, huh, Monica?
All right.
It's really love that found its way.
the strange happiness.
Real sweet, Monica. Wonderful, wonderful. Folks, I'm sure that that you all read of the heroic efforts of Captain Carlson and the loss of the merchant ship, the Flying Enterprise. However, tonight, for this special occasion, we've had the Flying Enterprise raised and we've towed it to Fort Ord. And here it is now, Bob Hope. Thank you, Captain Bligh.
Now, Mr. Christian, come down here.
Look who's calling me the Flying Enterprise. I've been towing you for years, Dad.
That's not me dragging behind you there.
And that's not a streetcar named Desire trailing you either.
I may say, though, candidly, it's a joy. It's really sheer heaven having you at Pebble Beach.
All that?
Yes.
And no money, isn't that so? Sheer heaven and no money.
Just to have you at Pebble Beach as my house guest.
Well, I may do all right on that deal.
You're telling me, you burglar.
What do you mean, burglar?
I looked in your suitcase. I found a gem in it.
It's just to get into the bathroom. I ran out of nickels.
Now, listen, I'm glad that you came up here to Fort Ord with me, Bob.
I am, too.
But I want to tell you one thing, Lard. I'm still sore about the... I'm still sore about the trip up here. That's the last automobile trip I take with you.
Weren't you comfortable?
Comfortable?
Yeah.
How did I know there were going to be seven of us in the front seat? What a sneak you are, putting an ad in the paper that said, "Wealthy philanthropist traveling north wants company on trip for laughs."
Well, what's wrong with that?
You charged us $20 a piece.
I'm still laughing.
And to think I had a reservation on the Continental Trailways bus.
Quit beeping. I bought your lunch on the way up here, didn't I?
Yeah, but I felt so silly sitting there with my pants rolled up so you'd only have to pay for a child's plate.
Well, after lunch, didn't I pick you up and burp you? Huh?
Yeah, but while you had me over your shoulder, you picked my pocket.
Yeah. Beautiful haul I got out of that. Two Dewey buttons and a lock of Marjorie Maine's hair.
Please, there's some things a gentleman doesn't discuss.
Oh, pardon my gauche briche. I'm sorry here.
I don't have that.
Well, listen, let's talk about Fort Ord. You know the...
Ooh.
This is where the new inductees...
Gonzaga talk. Gauche briche. Wait a minute.
Say, this is where the new inductees here at Fort Ord go through basic training. They learn to face all the dangers, face all the hardships that they might experience under fire.
So that's why they brought your show up here.
No, that's why we got you as guest.
Well, you sure.
It's even. Sounds like a dead heat, don't it?
But, you know, they sure do draft the fellas in a hurry here. Did you see that one guy who was all bent over?
Yeah, what happened to him?
It's not far from the beach.
What?
Well, that's what it says here.
Wait a minute. Go back there. You skipped a page.
Oh, yeah, I thought that was pretty dull for a punchline.
What is that? Wait a minute.
Far from the beach. Isn't that awful?
Wait, we're on page 50.
Oh, yeah.
Do one page at a time.
No, okay, okay. Let's try it
again.
Want
to try again?
Stick out your tongue so I can wet my thumb. Okay. Thank you.
Let's see now. Where, oh, you do that line about the guys being drafted. First,
okay, right? I say, you know, they sure do draft the fellas in a hurry here. Did you see that one guy who's all bent over?
Yeah, what happened to him?
Well, he was a plumber and they drafted him before he could get out from under the sink he was fixing. It's not far from the breach. I think I like that better.
That sounds like the kind of a line you'd give me on your show.
At least I don't glue your pages together.
Well, drop in again. We'll glue you together.
You got the horses for it.
But oh, wait, wait, now.
Keep looking. You'll find a beach in there somewhere. But listen, anyway, on the level, Bing, the Army can lead to a great career. Look at what General Eisenhower has done.
That's right. I understand if they draft him, he's going to run.
Some of the fellas here tried that, but they caught him and brought him back.
Well, I should think the boys would love it here. After all, they have a chance to learn a trade. Why, just a while ago, I saw a fella out behind the mess hall peeling potatoes.
Peeling potatoes? What kind of a trade is that?
Wonderful. He traded with the guy who was peeling onions. And, you know, recreation facilities are excellent, too. They have ping pong, shuffleboard, and if they feel like it, the fellas can go swimming in the surf.
It's not far from the beach. So that's where the line fits, you little rascal, you. I loved you the first time I said you. Yes, I did.
You really like that line.
I may adopt it. I think it needs a home. But I feel right at home here at Fort Ord. You know, I'm making a picture at Paramount called Military Policeman with Marilyn Maxwell.
Oh, what a nice area to police.
You're thinking right. You know, it's not often you find a Maxwell with a Cadillac body.
Tell me.
But it's interesting making a picture about the MPs, Bing. These guys are some... You know, these MPs are some of the roughest, toughest characters you'll ever meet.
Oh, well, that's bad. You're mistaken. That's bad casting. Why, as a group, the military policemen are the kindest, gentlest, most soft-spoken, obliging boys in the Army.
I guess I haven't met them all, huh?
No, MPs are different, Bob, than they used to be. Why, here at Fort Ord, MP stands for Marvelously Pleasant.
That's funny. I always thought it stood for muscles and poison. No.
Well, you're wrong. You're wrong, Bob. See, I can prove it. I've got a little skit here that we've written. It shows that just how the military police at Fort Ord operate. And I got a gal here that's going to help us out with the skit, too. Monica, come on over here, will you?
Yes, Bing. What is it?
Well, look what he's been hiding in his duffel bag.
Don't you know Monica, Bob? She's going to help.
It's not far from the beach.
Now, wait.
Her coastline reminded
you
me of that.
You look out. Settle down. Down, down more. Listen, she's going to help us with our sketch. Monica, this is Bob Hope.
Oh, I know Bob. I've seen him on television.
Brave girl.
I may do a TV show for the U.S. Rubber Company.
Well, that's fair enough. You've been wearing their girdles for years. You know, work for them.
At least I don't make my own out of Scotch tape and never leak.
What about the sketch, boy?
Oh, yes, the sketch. Mm-hmm. Pardon us, Monica. Bob, you're going to play a part of a young rookie G.I.
Yes.
Monica is your girlfriend, and I'm a typical military policeman. Shall we, then?
It's not far from the beach. No. I may want to drive.
Music, John.
We now take you to a secluded, wooded side road on the Monterey Peninsula. It's a beautiful, balmy evening, and the stars twinkle down upon a boy and a girl seated in a Jeep.
Isn't this a wonderful night, honey?
It sure is.
You know, all my life I've been saving my kisses for a girl just like you.
And tonight you'd like to lose your life savings, huh?
Yep, I want to shoot the works. Wowie!
Let go of me. And what's the matter with you?
Long time no she.
Behave yourself and read that comic book I brought you.
Okay, hold the flashlight. Golly, this is a thriller.
Shall I read it to you?
Yeah, just the printing. I'm good on pictures. Oh, boy. This is the biggest night of my life. Just think, a date with a Salinas girl.
It's a big night for me, too. Just think, a date with a volunteer lettuce picker.
But, Monica, really, I'm crazy about you. I really am. And I want to tell you that I... What's that, a critic?
That's supposed to be a motorcycle. We forgot to bring a sound man.
Boy, what a cheap show. How'd I get trapped?
Never mind that. Now, may I see your pass, soldier?
Golly, it's a military policeman.
Oh, please, Mr. MP, sir. Go easy on me. I know this racket, you know. Don't drag me off to the guardhouse. I'm innocent, I tell you. I'm innocent.
Now, don't be afraid, my boy. I'm here to help you.
You are?
Of course.
Oh, then hold this girl. I want to kiss her.
Well, if you two want a neck, I better hop on my motorcycle and plunge off into the darkness.
It's not far to the beach. How'd that line get in there?
Now, young man, I don't want to be a pest or anything, but inasmuch as you're off the post and it's 3 o'clock in the morning, I would like to know if you have a pass.
Pass?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Here's my pass.
Thank you. This is a pass from World War I.
Well, I am a little overdue.
Well, now, don't you let it worry your pretty little head.
I feel like a cad.
You know, I've never ridden on a motorcycle.
Oh, you haven't? Well, come on, I'll take you for a ride right now.
Oh, thank you.
And now, wait a minute.
No, don't interfere. Just hop right up here, miss.
Okay.
Well, good night.
Good night.
Goodbye, Bob.
Monica, come back. You mean everything to me. You can't leave me alone.
Why not?
Well, who's going to hold a flashlight for my comic book?
Monica and I and Bob have a little personalized version here of a current pop ditty. I think he might get a jar out of it. You ready, Monica?
Mm-hmm.
John Scott? Buddy Cole? Go.
Wish I was a bumblebee by heck. I wish I was a bumblebee by heck. If I was a bumblebee by heck, I'd buzz around Gregory Peck. I wish I was a bumblebee by heck.
Now, wait a minute. What do you want with Gregory Peck?
Yeah, what are we, chicken liver or something? What we do?
You do, but not with me.
Ay, ay, ay.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, I want to be a bumblebee.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, a bumblebee is what she wants to be.
All right, Bob, it's your turn. Is there anything you'd like to be?
No, I'm content. After all, I'm charming, talented, lovable. Who could ask for anything more?
If I think you'll come up with something.
Okay, but I may have to press a little.
Come on.
I wish I was a lemon custard pie. I wish I was a lemon custard pie. If I was a lemon custard pie, I'd throw myself in Crosby's eye. I wish I...
That's very clever, Bob.
Did you like it?
Yes. Now I shall get even.
I'll take it easy, bud. You know my temper and my muscles.
Your muscles?
Sure. On a clear day, I'm often mistaken for Mr. America.
Oh. How well I wish I was a muscle man like you. I wish I was a muscle man like you. If I was a muscle man like you, I'd tear a Kleenex right in two. I wish I was a muscle man like you.
Now I've got one.
No, you've had yours. We got to go for the finish.
What a sneak.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, this is what we like to be.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee.
Hi-ho, fiddly-dee,
this is what we think we'd like to be.
joining in with me and once over lightly on sound off.
Well, I thought you asked me over here to do something funny.
I did. Sing. Last night I saw my favorite spy.
You did? Well, how did you like it, guy?
I went and got my money back and spent it for my favorite pack of Chesterfield.
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 Milder, 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 milder Chesterfield. That's right, you've seen my picture, I presume.
Oh, yes, you mean here comes the gloom. Mm-hmm. The audience slept right through it all. To wake them up, I had to call. Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Sound off
for Chesterfield. Try a pack of Chesterfields and
it. Today!
Friends, when you smoke Chesterfield, you're going with the very best. That Chesterfield mildness plus no unpleasant aftertaste means smoke and pleasure all the way. So lay your money on the line for one that's got it all. Enjoy your smoking. Change to Chesterfield today. Right. John, go ahead.
Just one more chance to prove it's you alone I care for. Each night I say a little prayer for. Just one more chance. Just one more night to taste those kisses that enchant me. I'd want no others if you'd grant me just one more chance. I've learned the meaning of repentance. Now you're the jury at my trial. I know that I should serve my sentence. Still, I'm hoping all the while you'll give me just one more word. I said that I was glad to start out, but now I'm back to cry my heart out for just one more chance. I've learned the meaning of repentance. Now you're the jury at my trial. I know that I should serve my sentence. Still, I'm hoping all the while you'll give me just one more word. I said that I was glad to start out, but now I'm back to cry my heart out for just one more
chance. The closer for this evening. Now my thanks to Monica Lewis, Bob Hope, and all those who joined us here at Fort Ord for this evening's show. We'd like to tell you folks listening that the soldiers here on this post contribute 2,000 pints of blood every month to the Red Cross.
Isn't that wonderful? And you know the boys here bought over $300,000 worth of bonds in the recent defense bond drive?
And this post has contributed over $50,000 to local charities.
Yes, sir. I want to tell you, this is some outfit. Thanks also now to General McClure, Colonel Solomon, and the special services and all who have been so very nice to us here on our visit. Folks, we'll be back on the air next Wednesday, same time, but I sincerely hope you won't wait till then to try Chesterfield's. Latch onto a pack or a carton right away. Enjoy your smoking. Change to Chesterfield's today and get smoking pleasure all the way.
Show presented by Chesterfield was produced and transcribed at Fort Ord, California by Bill Morrow and Myrtle McKenzie. Tune in next week and hear Bing and his guest, Paul Douglas.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Noble Hospital, a brand new name for a Westfield institution which is improving the health of our community every day with quality and compassion. Noble Hospital and Bay State Health, better together.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Arts Beat, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Golden, and this is J-Pack Luca with JP's Golden Age of Radio. Pete Coles is on the other side of the window over there, making this all happen.
Putting together stuff.
We're
expanding. We're putting in a permanent link between Studio 120 and WSKB.
Which I don't have any idea what that means, so that's okay.
It's a permanent audio bridge so that students can run this if I'm away, and they don't have to worry about a connection and then another connection and another connection to make it work.
And I don't know what any of that means. So
yes, you do.
Well, but our listeners don't know, and I, you know.
I mean, try to educate our listeners.
Well, what we're going to try and do is make this transparent to all of our listeners so they have no idea what goes on behind the background.
That's
hey,
okay,
Bing
too.
Crosby and Bob Hope back during the war years used to do a lot of remote shows in front of our troops around the world. That was one of those. So we'll run those from time to time, and hopefully we'll never have another time when the world is at war like that. So boy, it sure does seem like at this time our war is against something we can't see right now, and hopefully we will fight that battle every day, and we're going to beat it. Next up, we have Fred Allen, who was kind of there was a friendly rivalry between Fred Allen and Jack Benny, and that went on for years and years and years, and it was always fun when the two of them got together on stage, but also it was fun when they would trade barbs on their own shows, sometimes without the others knowing. So
this is an episode with Bing Crosby.
Then we're going to
guest star Bing Crosby. Yeah. Guest star Bing Crosby.
Then we're going to run that right now. JP's Golden Age of Radio.
The Ford Dealers of America present the Fred Allen Show. The Fred Allen Show with Fred's guest, Bing Crosby, Minerva Pius, Peter Donald, Parker Fenley, the DeMarco sisters, and Al Goodman and his orchestra. And this is Kenny Delmar speaking for your friendly Ford dealer. If you've been in Detroit lately, you know everyone saying, watch Ford. Perhaps you've been trying to pump your Ford dealer to get some inside advance information. Well, your Ford dealer can begin to give you a few facts about the car, but he says, wait till you see it. After all, the brand new 49 Ford will soon be here. Soon you can see for yourself the car with the look of the year, the ride of the year,
In fact, it's the car of the year. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last day of National Airmail Week. And paying a tribute to National Airmail Week, we bring you a mail who shouldn't be on the air. He's Fred Allen.
Thank you and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Kenny, I hope you observed National Airmail Week.
Yes, I was high all week.
I had better jokes than that before the show and nothing happened. No kidding. And they said... you were high all week, and they said that you would never get you off the ground. Well, you showed them, Kenny.
Yeah, well, did you celebrate National Airmail Week, Frank?
Yes, Kenny. All week I smoked wings. You know, people today don't appreciate our airmail service, Kenny. Do you realize how many people it takes, truck drivers, messengers on motorcycles, pilots on planes, and postmen on foot to get an airmail letter from here to California?
Yeah, it sure is some operation.
Yes, it is, Kenny. Where else can you get that much action for practically nothing?
Only at a Wallace rally.
Right you are. Say, Kenny, I forgot. Did you know that this week we are also starting National Foot Week?
Say, National Foot Week reminds me.
Reminds you?
Yeah, feet remind me of dogs, and dogs remind me of Frankfurters.
So?
If the Bakers go on strike this week, the baseball parks will have no rolls to go with their hot dogs.
No rolls?
No rolls.
Kenny, with the new Ford coming out, who's worried about the rolls?
I'm sorry, Fred. I can't laugh at that joke.
Well, nothing to be embarrassed about. You weren't the only one, Kenny. You want to give it some thought? Are you sure?
Positive.
Kenny, it so happens this weekend the Ford dealers are having their convention here in New York. They are here to see for the first time the new Ford car. Kenny, tonight, every man in our audience is a Ford dealer. And the Ford dealers, as you may have heard, are our sponsors.
Fred, what was that joke again?
With the new Ford coming out, who's worried about the road? Kenny, you're... Kenny, you are in the bag for next year. Tell me what... Now it's my time to worry. What else is new?
Well, some lady in Washington is campaigning to have women's faces put on paper money.
Say, why should women have their faces on money? They've got their hands on most of the money now, Kenny. And speaking of money, did you hear Jack Benny's program tonight?
Yeah, Jack wasn't on his program last week.
I know. You know, I thought the show was much stronger last Sunday than tonight.
Robert Taylor took Jack's place.
Well, that shows you with that program, Kenny. Anybody can take Jack Benny's place. A tailor, a shoemaker, a street cleaner, a barbecue pit operator. What are you laughing at?
Well, with the new Ford coming out, who's worried about the role?
Oh, now, wait a minute. Kenny, before you start overdoing it, I think I had better leave here and get going in the general direction of Allen's Alley.
Well, what is your question tonight, Fred?
Well, this past week, the United Parents Committee urged parents to listen to the radio with their children and to set aside definite periods for family listening. And so our question is, what are you doing about your radio listening?
Shall we go?
As the two snowballs said when they started rolling downhill, who's going to stop us? Ah, it's a wonderful night in Allen's Alley, Kenny. Say, there are some planks missing from the Claghorn front steps. Look. The senator must be putting his platform together. Oh, well, let's knock.
Somebody's belaboring my clabbers. Oh, it's you, son.
Yes, Senator.
Accelerate, son. I'm busier than the jockey's whip on a long shot coming down the stretch. I just got back Morrigan. I went out to hear that Stass and Dewey debate.
Well, how did the debate come out, Senator?
Well, as the new bride said when she broke the egg in the coffee grounds, it didn't settle nothing. People say Stassen's ideas will drive the communists underground. That's a lot of gobbledygook.
Gobbledygook?
Son, today you can't go underground unless you see one man.
Harold Stassen?
John L. Lewis.
Well, tell me, what about Mr. Dewey?
Dewey says keep the communists out in the open.
So?
With the communists out in the open, you can't tell them from everybody else. Yeah, with the housing shortage, everybody's out in the open.
Well, Senator, where do you think the communists should go?
Don't tempt me, son. I'm on the air. If you see me after the program. The place I got in mind will melt that iron curtain.
But look.
Sic semper non sequitur nux vomico.
What is that?
It's Latin.
Well, I know it's Latin, but what does it mean?
Go ask your druggist, son.
Well, Senator, our question tonight is about radio listening. What program do you listen to?
Well, son, there's only one way they can get me to listen to the radio.
How?
They get all the Republicans together and put them, all those Republicans, on one program.
All the Republicans? Well, what would you call the program?
People Are Funny. So long, son. So long, Eddie.
Well, the Senator's got something here. Let's see how Mr. Moody feels about it.
Howdy, bub.
Well, tell me, Mr. Moody, what about your radio listening?
Why, I used to keep a radio in the barn.
Yeah?
I'd turn it on while I was doing my chores.
Well, what was your favorite program?
The Grand Ole Opry.
You liked the Grand Ole Opry, eh?
Yeah. One minute I was laughing, and next minute I was crying.
Yeah?
And then I was laughing and crying together.
Your emotions alternated.
I was laughing and crying together.
Uh-huh, well, that's what I...
When Red Foley would sing this bale a new alfalfa I cut from mother's grave, I'd bend over the milk pail and start crying fit to bust.
Well, I can see how you'd be affected.
Yeah, and then Rod Brasfield, the fellow from Hole in the Wall, Tennessee.
Yes?
He'd start cutting didos and I'd be rolling in the hay, tittering and laughing like a loon.
Oh, good. You're enjoying that.
And then Red Foley'd sing, I rapped on the hearse, Granny darling, but Granny, you didn't look out. And then I'd start blubbering again.
Well, tell me, are you still listening to Grand Ole Opry?
No, radio's broke.
What happened?
Well, one of my hens is nearsighted.
Nearsighted?
One night after I turned off Grand Ole Opry.
Yes.
This hen, she crawled inside the radio.
Uh-huh.
She backed into something that felt round.
One of the tubes, eh?
Yeah, it was still warm.
Uh-huh.
Well, the hen being nearsighted, she thought she'd laid an egg.
Oh, yes.
She backed up and she sat on it.
You mean that hen?
She sat on that tube until she hatched it.
Your hen hatched a radio tube, or what came out?
A big chicken that's the spitting image of Mary Margaret McBride. So long.
That's silly. Mary Margaret's no chicken. Anyone would know. Let's try this next door.
Howdy, Chappy.
Oh, Mrs. Nussbaum. Tell me, do you listen to the radio?
Not lately. Confidentially from Mrs. Bloomberg, I'm learning my lesson.
What happened? What happened to Mrs. Bloomberg?
Well, always Mrs. Bloomberg is going to quiz programs.
Oh, quiz programs, huh?
On a program, taking it or we will giving it to you. For barking like a dog while blindfolded.
Yes.
Mrs. Bloomberg is winning a refrigerator, also a motorboat autographed by Guy Lombardo.
Okay. Mrs. Bloomberg was lucky.
On Truth and Subsequences. For dancing the Big Apple with a wildcat.
Yes.
She's winning a sleeping bag. Also, a guaranteed moose call.
Oh, say, enough.
And on Cover Girl for a Day, she is winning 200 manhole covers.
Mrs. Bloomberg had a streak.
Oh, on Morons Are Suddenly Millionaires.
Yes.
For eating an antipasto with chopsticks.
Yes.
While sitting in 2 pounds pot cheese.
Yes.
Also, simultaneously singing Nature Boy.
Yes.
She is winning a diesel locomotive with 2 miles of track.
She is going places, Mrs. Bloomberg. Radio, I must say, has been good to Mrs. B.
Also, it is her undoing.
Undoing? Where is Mrs. Bloomberg today?
She is living wearing a Mandarin coat in Japan.
In Japan?
Well, last year on a program, everybody is going on a vacation.
Yes.
Mrs. Bloomberg is winning a ticket to Tokyo, first class.
Well, why can't Mrs. Bloomberg get back from Japan?
The ticket is only one way.
Thank you. I see. Yes. Well, one more call and we can leave the alley. I wonder if Mr. Cassidy is around.
Here, now, what's on the door? I'm not going to take out three at a time. Oh, no, will you? Oh,
Well, Mr. Cassidy, how are you tonight?
Oh, terrible, terrible, terrible.
What's wrong?
I got Alaskan indigestion.
Alaskan indigestion?
I've been eating too much of that frozen food.
Frozen food?
For 2 days I've been coughing up snow.
Golly.
Look at the front of me suit.
Say, what's all that white stuff?
My stomach's so cold, it's frost on me vest.
Frost?
If I ever get gas on me stomach, it'll be a blizzard, or...
Well, Ajax, what about your radio listening?
Well, once a week, as regular as clockwork, I turn on the radio.
What programs do you tune in?
Only one program, me boy, the University of Chicago Roundtable.
Well, how come, Ajax, you listen to an intellectual show like the University of Chicago Roundtable?
I happen to be a charter member of the Third Avenue Guild for the Preservation of Culture and Genteel Tippling.
Culture and genteel tippling?
Once a week, the guild meets in the back room at Kerrigan's Cozy Corner.
I see.
First, the grand omnipotent pharaoh calls the roll.
The roll?
Then every paid-up member is served a quart of liquor and a small individual barrel of beer.
I see.
Then the bottles are opened and the bung starters commence their foamy function.
Uh-huh.
As glasses are set up, I lean over, you see. I turn on the radio and tune in the University of Chicago Roundtable.
And then?
The Third Avenue Guild for the Preservation of Culture and Genteel Tippling starts to carry out its lofty objectives.
And as the program goes on...
We ignore it. We don't know what they're talking about.
Then why do you tune in the Roundtable?
Or to remind us.
The Roundtable reminds you of what?
To have round after round until we're under the table. Goodbye.
Goodman has finally gotten himself in the mood to play. The five DeMarco sisters, courtesy to Maestro Goodman, all is ready, and the DeMarco sing Betty Blue. Girls?
Betty Blue likes Bobby Gray, and she likes Bill White, too. Gray and White come round each night to woo young Betty Blue. Betty Blue likes Georgie Green, and Tom Brown thrills her too. And all the town knows Green and Brown are sweet on Betty Blue. Each night the ribbon in her hair is gray or green or white. The one whose color that she wears can stay and hold her die. Does Betty Blue love gray or brown, green or white or ooh? Oh, Betty, who's your steady, pretty Betty Blue? Charlie Black, and ooh, she likes him too.
Gray and White got such a fright when they saw Black and Blue.
Now gray and brown and green and white are in a stew. Betty's wacky over Blackie, and the boys are blue over Betty.
Thank you, girls. And now, ladies and gentlemen.
Say, Fred.
Yes, Kenny?
How would you like to have a big job?
A big job? You mean like being vice president in charge of shad at the Fulton Fish Market?
Yeah, no, Fred. I'm talking about the new Ford big job, uh-huh. The most powerful truck Ford has ever built. It has a big 145-horsepower engine and a gross train weight rating of 39,000 pounds.
Say, that is a big job.
Yeah, and the big job is only one of over 139 great new Ford truck models, and they're all bonus built. Built extra strong to last longer. It's no wonder they're the big truck news today.
Well, look, I could have used a Ford truck 30 years ago, Kenny, when I was in vaudeville, you know, juggling and carrying my cannonballs and Indian clubs around.
Now, Fred, you ought to go back into vaudeville.
You really think so? Why?
In a Ford truck's new million-dollar cab, you'd be the most comfortable juggler on the road.
Yeah?
All the drivers are raving about it.
Kenny, why tell me about the new Ford trucks and the million-dollar cab? Vaudeville is dead. I can't use a truck today.
Fred, I just want you to see the new Ford trucks. You'll go crazy about them.
And if I go crazy?
That'll make it unanimous. Everybody else is crazy about the new Ford trucks. It's the hottest truck line in years.
Well, I'll see what I... If this number had been finished, it would have been Tell Me a Story, played by Maestro Al Goodman and 25 bookmakers who followed the maestro home from Belmont Park the opening day. And now, say, Kenny.
Yes, Fred.
Say, I just remembered. Have you a piece of paper? I have to write my weekly letter to Portland.
Well, here's part of a radio script on this table.
Oh, thanks. Say, this is the back page of Front Page Faro. I can write on this. Well, let me see. May 23rd, the date. Dear Portland, glad you liked last Sunday's program with Gracie Fields. You are wrong. I sang the song with Gracie. It wasn't Frank Munn. This week, I finished reading a new book. It's The Life of Bing Crosby, and it gave me a great idea. If I could only find Bing. I heard he was in New York incognito, using the name William Morrow. So last Thursday, I started out to track him down. Ah, this is the hotel, and this must be the Crosby suite. I just saw a horse go in the other door. Say, I wonder if Bing is in here still incognito. Well, I'll knock.
Yes?
Mr. William Morrow?
No, my name is Bing Crosby.
Well, Bing,
Look, bud, if you're a song plugger or something, I do all my business through Nick Kenny, the writer of Moon Over Mother's Day. And if it's about baseball, the Pirates have a bat, boy. So just
you're
trying to get Dorothy Lamour's telephone number. It'll cost you $15. That's what Hope charged me.
Well, Bing, you remember me? I'm Fred Allen.
Oh, Fred?
Yes. Capital A.
I didn't recognize you, yeah. Fred. You look wonderful.
I do.
Well, the last time I saw you, you looked like a medical student's homework.
Well, I'll tell you why I'm here, Bing. I just finished reading that new book about your life.
Oh, how does the story finish? How do I end up?
You haven't read the book?
Oh, I've been too busy. I've been out hustling it.
Bing, you mean
that
you...
Oh, not only me. I've got Dixie and the kids. They're out peddling the book door to door.
No kidding.
Yeah, yesterday one of my kids had a little trouble, though.
What trouble?
Well, he was going from house to house, you see. And he ran into Jim Farley working the same block with his book.
Jim Farley was out peddling?
Yes, and Jim is rough competition. You see, with the Farley story, Jim gives away a bottle of Coke.
Oh, I see.
We can't have no premiums.
Bing, you and I can take this book and make the story of your life. Make a picture of it. It'll gross $4 million.
Oh, no, Fred, I'm too busy.
Too busy to make $4 million?
Well, Fred, you can't take it with you, you know.
Well, I know. But when Gabriel blows his horn, Bing, you can come back and look around for it. What do you say, Bing?
Oh, no, Fred. I got a lot of things to do. I have to be out at the ballpark every day with the Pittsburgh Pirates, you know. When we have a night game, I have to hold the lantern.
You hold the lantern?
Yeah.
Oh, Bing, why don't you forget about baseball?
Forget it. Why, this year, Pittsburgh's going to win the pennant.
Pittsburgh?
Yeah.
What's wrong with the Dodgers?
That's what the Brooklyn fans want to know.
Tell me, what do you do when you're not with the Pirates?
Well, during the day, I'm generally tied up playing golf.
Yeah.
My nights are fraught with banquets and speaking engagements.
Speaking engagements?
Yes. Last night at the Philco Dealers Convention, I gave a short talk entitled, You Can Have Fun, with the 1201.
This was for the Philco Dealers.
Yes, and then we had a rather spirited debate on whether the Philco television could be seen more clearly through a glass of beer or a highball.
Oh, that must have been interesting.
I handled the rebuttal for the highball.
Well, tell me, where else have you spoken?
Oh, I've been around. Last Tuesday, I was guest of honor at a chicken plucker's banquet in the Bronx.
Oh.
And Friday, I gave an exhibition at Roseland to plug my new picture, The Emperor's Waltz.
At Roseland?
Yeah.
Gad, Bing, you are a busy man.
Oh, yes. Tonight, I may appear with Jack Eigen if I can find out who he is. Who is this, Jack? Are you going to tell me later, aren't you?
Yes, I give you
What's
a plain, sealed envelope. Bing, I tell you what I'll do. If you let me make the picture of your life, I will tell you who Jack Eigen is. Honor bright.
Done, by George. How does your story go?
Well, of course, you're the star.
Naturally.
The picture opens in 1925. We open in Spokane, Washington. You are 10 years old. The first scene is the living room of the Crosby home.
Have no bananas. We have no bananas.
Bing. Oh, Bing.
Yes, Ma?
Is that you singing again?
It's a new song, Ma. Yes, we have no bananas.
Singing? You're always singing. Why aren't you ambitious like your brothers?
But, Ma.
Look at your brother Larry up at 4 o'clock every morning with his paper route.
Yes, Ma.
And brother Bob, the only boy with Western Union who owns his own bicycle.
Yes, Ma.
And little Everett working at the A&P. Why, every week, Everett brings home $3 and all the groceries he can carry.
But, Ma!
You and your father are the only ones in the whole family not working.
Sit down, Ma. I'll sing you a song.
All right, Bing, but this is the last song today. Go ahead, son.
What a scene.
You like this?
That voice you had as a little boy. Tell me, when did your voice change?
The day Phil Spitalny made me an offer.
That was tough.
I wasn't discouraged, though, Fred. I packed my bag, borrowed Brother Bob's bicycle, and I left Spokane for New York.
Well, how old were you?
By the time I arrived in New York, I was 20.
Great. When? Uphill, eh?
Yes.
When did you get your first break?
Well, one day I went to my agent's office.
Yeah.
Hello, Rosie.
Oh, it's you again, Crosby.
Any bookings for me today, Rosie?
Look, Crosby, I only book talents. You ain't got none. Now pick up your rhinestone megaphone and skidoo.
Oh, but Rosie, with the megaphone, I can be another Rudy Valley.
Who needs another Rudy Valley? How's it gonna look 20 years from now with two Rudy Valleys out of work?
Oh, but Rosie, I even had my eyes slanted.
Rosie, you gotta help us out.
Yeah, what's up, Al?
The rhythm boys are in trouble, Rosie.
You hocked your tuxedos?
No. Our baritone's sick. The doctor says it may be malnutrition.
Malnutrition? If that's an epidemic, I'm getting vaccinated.
Rosie, you've got to get us a baritone.
Wait, what about me, fellas? I can sing baritone.
Well, who are you? What's your name, kid?
Bing Crosby.
Bing, my name's Al Rinker. This is Harry Barris.
Well, I'm glad to know you fellas.
Well,
give me a chance with the rhythm boys, will you? I'll make good.
Okay, Bing, do you know Bye Bye Blues?
Oh, sure.
Let's see what you can do. 1, 2. Don't sigh, don't cry. Bye bye. I said bye bye.
Mean
bye bye blues. this will be a high spot in the picture.
Well, I guess so. The day I joined the Rhythm Boys, I was on my way.
Well, what happened next?
Opportunity knocked with a sledgehammer.
Opportunity?
A man named Hooper invented the radio.
Oh, say, I remember Hooper. In the early days, Hooper was calling people up to see what they were listening to, and they were listening to each other. Well, Hooper fixed that. He invented the radio.
Yes, sir. And when Hooper turned around, there I was with Ma Perkins.
Great, we'll have a close-up of your first sponsor looking out of a cheese.
Great.
Next, we'll show, you know how they do in pictures, show the wheels of a Greyhound bus spinning. You're on your way to Hollywood.
Oh, this is great.
Yes, this'll be revolutionary. Tell me, Bing, why did you go to Hollywood?
Well, I needed the money. I had a family to support.
A wife and children?
My brothers.
Your brothers? I thought they were the ambitious ones.
Things have been going against the boys, Fred. Oh. Larry lost his paper route.
And Bob?
Western Union had started those singing telegrams that let Bob out.
Oh, naturally.
The only one working was Everett.
He was still with the A&P?
And doing rather well. Oh, Everett was bigger. He could carry more home.
Bing, I've got it. An inspiration. Forget the family angle. The next scene is the Paramount Studio. You're going into pictures.
Sounds great.
Cecil B. DeMille is directing Barry Fitzgerald in The Road to Dublin. As the scene opens, Cecil is introducing you to Barry Fitzgerald.
Barry, this is the stuntman for your picture, Bing Crosby.
I'm glad to know you, Mr. Fitzgerald.
Well, I'm the star of the picture. Frankly, I'm disappointed.
Disappointed in me, Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes, they promised me Buster Crabbe.
Well, Buster and I have the same initials.
And they're the resemblance ends. I don't think you do, Mr. Crosby.
Oh, but Mr. Fitzgerald, I can act.
Well, we'll soon find out. Now, take this script. I'll give you an audition.
Yes, sir.
The scene is a peat bog in Ireland. You are playing me half-witted son. Now, let me hear you read your part.
Okay. Faith and bedad and bejabbers and bad cesty begot at the back of the shillelagh to you and thaw shay thickum to gaily and fog a baller. How was that?
It's terrible. I can't use you in the picture at all.
Why not?
Well, you've got an Irish accent. You speak with a definite brow.
But Mr. Fitzgerald...
No. Where's Mr. DeMille? Close me out. Get me Buster Crabbe.
Please, Mr. Fitzgerald, before you get Buster, give me one more chance. Maybe I can't act, but I can sing.
Well, we might be able to use a song in the picture. Let me hear you. Go ahead, sing, Mr. Crosby.
Oh, thanks, Mr. Fitzgerald.
In dreams I kiss your hand, madam. Your dainty fingertips. And while in slumberland, madam, I'm begging for your lips. I haven't any right, madam, to do the things I do. Just when I hold you tight, madam, you vanish with the night, madam. In dreams I kiss your hand, madam, and I pray my dreams come.
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
WNBC FM, New York.
Support for community radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
The Jack Benny Program.
Lucky Strike means fine tobacco.
L-S-M-F-T, L-S-M-F-T, L-S-M-F-T.
You said it. Yes, sir.
Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. At 49,
American. Quality of product is essential to continuing success.
And Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw.
When it comes to real, deep down smoking enjoyment, remember these five words. Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Yes, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. The finer, the lighter, the naturally milder Lucky Strike tobacco.
So for your own real deep-down smoking enjoyment, smoke that smoke of fine tobacco, Lucky Strike. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw.
And for that Christmas present, remember...
L-S-M-F-T.
Suggestion, a carton of cigarettes for Christmas. No gift offers so much for so little. So say Merry Christmas with a carton of Lucky Strike.
The Lucky Strike Program, starring Jack Benny, with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester, Larry Stevens, and yours truly, Don Wilson. Ladies and gentlemen, 2 weeks ago, Jack Benny had dinner at Mr. and Mrs. Ronaldman's house. And tonight, as a typical good neighbor, Jack has invited the Colemans over to his house. So let's go out to Beverly Hills, where we find Jack preparing for the arrival of his distinguished guests.
Well, I'm almost dressed, Rochester. How do I look in my striped pants and swallowtail coat?
You look like a master of ceremonies at Forest Lawn.
I do not. Now, Rochester, when you're serving dinner tonight, remember, serve tomato juice first, then the salad, then the meat, and then the vegetables.
I'm glad you brought that up, boss. I wanted to ask you about the peas.
What about the peas?
Do you want me to spoon them out or count them out?
Spoon them out tonight. There's nothing too good for the Colemans. And, don't forget, for dessert, we're having a flaming plum pudding.
How do you fix it, boss?
Well, you take pudding and put it in a bowl.
Uh-huh.
Then you take a pint of brandy, good brandy, you know, real old brandy, and you pour it over the pudding.
Continue, boss. You fascinate me.
Then you take a match and set fire to the brandy.
You what?
You take a match and set fire to the brandy.
Boss, I doubt if I'll have the heart.
Well, just do as I tell you. See you later. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle dum da ding, dum 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 dum. Gee, I hope the gang got all those contest letters cleaned up. I don't want the Colemans to find out that so many people can't stand me. Well, kids, are you about finished with the mail?
We're all through, Jack, except for those entries over there in the corner.
Why haven't you opened those?
They're still ticking.
Ticking? You mean... Hey, there's one that's smoking. Quick, Don, throw it out the window.
Okay.
I wonder why the... Fine Christmas spirit. That thing could have...
Hello, Mr. Benny.
Huh? Who are you?
I was just passing by and something blew me in.
Oh, well, Merry Christmas.
Yeah, same to you. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Now, kids, we've got to get all these letters read because the contest ends tomorrow night, December 24th, you know.
Say, Jack, listen to this letter I just opened. I think it's from a Scotch girl.
A Scotch girl? What does it say?
I can't stand Jack Benny because his nose is warmer than mine. Signed, Lassie.
Oh, she's just mad because she read that big story about me in Newsweek. Anyway, kids, never mind the rest of those letters. Mr. and Mrs. Coleman will be here for dinner soon. I also invited their friend, Jack Wellington. So please be on your best behavior. Especially you, Phil.
Me?
Yes, you. Just for tonight, don't bring your jug to the table with you. Please.
Now, wait a minute, Jackson. Have you ever tried eating that meat straight?
I know it's awful, Phil, but do it just as a favor to me. And another thing, Phil. When you take the jacket off the baked potato, you're not supposed to go... It's only a potato. And Don...
Yes, Jack?
Don, when Rochester offers you a third help, try to refuse, will you? Or at least, say well before you dive in. And Mary...
Oh, Jack, don't try to tell me anything about eating.
You better listen to him, Libby. He was eating 30 years before you were born.
Phil, your Christmas present isn't so big that I can't carry it back to the store. So don't try to... Oh, hello, Polly. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Isn't that cute? Say, kids, don't you think my Christmas tree is a beauty? Look how big it is.
It sure is, Mr. Benny. Where did you get it?
Well...
I'll tell you, kid. A man drove through Beverly Hills with that tree laying on top of his car, and Jackson was right behind him.
Phil.
Jackson knew about the sharp curve in the road, and the man didn't.
Phil, please. Christmas trees are very sentimental to me. In fact, I used to go out in the woods and cut down my own tree. But I gave that up.
Yeah, it's so hard to find one with packages under it.
Yeah. Anyway, this is the best Christmas tree I've ever had.
And look at all those presents. Say, Mr. Benny, what's in that great big box over there all top that red and green ribbon?
That's there every year, kid. It's a decoy.
It is not.
Oh, boss! Boss!
What is it, Rochester?
For dinner tonight, do you want French bread, raisin bread, or English muffins?
English muffins. Are they the real English muffins?
Are they? I cut one of them open and found two tickets to a cricket match.
Well, you can't go. You've got work to do. And by the way, I hired an English butler to help me serve tonight, so the Colemans will feel at home. He should be here any minute. Gosh, I bet right now Ronnie and Benita are sitting on pins and needles waiting to leave their house.
Oh, Ronnie! Ronnie, where are you?
Right here in the library, Benita.
Darling, it's almost 8 o'clock. It's time for over to Mr. Benny's house. Have you forgotten?
Oh, no, no. I haven't forgotten. It's been on my mind all week. Perhaps we can phone and make some excuse.
No, darling, we can't do that. He's probably gone to a great deal of trouble preparing dinner. In fact, just this afternoon, his butler... what's his butler's name again?
Manchester?
Yeah. Manchester. Well, he came to the back door and wanted to borrow some sugar, so I gave him a saucerful.
You gave him a saucerful?
Yes, they already have all our cups.
Yes, I wondered why Sherwood served my afternoon tea in a Dixie cup. But I guess you're right, Benita. Maybe we should go. I'll never forget when Benny invited us to his house 3 years ago and we didn't show up. You know, it made him so angry, he wrote a letter to Britain asking for his bundle back.
Oh, yes, well, he's probably sensitive. Well, it's getting late. You better start dressing.
Oh, yes, yes. And I mustn't forget to take Jack Benny's shoes back to him.
His shoes?
Yes, he slipped them off when he was having dinner here 2 weeks ago. I'd never seen such interesting shoes. There's so many secret pockets in them. And there's a little device in there where you wiggle your toes and it...
Well, so those shoes belong to Mr. Benny. I should have known they weren't yours when I saw the box spring in the arch support.
Yeah, I noticed that, too. By the way, Benita... Who's invited to the dinner besides us?
Well, I understand there'll be Mary Livingston. She's on his program, you know.
Mary Livingston. Didn't she at one time work behind the stocking counter at the May Company?
Yes, and I can't understand her giving a job like that. Now, let's see. Oh, yes, besides Mary Livingston, there'll be that Phil Harris fellow.
Oh, yes, Ham Hock Turnip Green. Say, Benita, couldn't we phone and say that Uncle Oswald is ill and we have to go and visit him?
You can't do that. After all, Mr. Benny lives right next door. He'll see our lights and know we're home.
Oh, yes, yes. Even that 30-foot fence doesn't keep him from peeping in on us. Creeping along his side of the fence with a periscope.
A
most remarkable fellow.
I do hope Mr. Benny doesn't insist on playing that violin tonight.
No, why? Benita, why did you have to bring that up? For 10 years, I've been plagued with love in bloom. I've hoped, I've wished. Yes, even prayed for a minor disaster, a fire, a tornado, even termites, anything. But destroy that violin.
Darling.
Well, if he can't be stopped, then in the name of heaven, let him play right. Give him the will. Give him the strength. Give him the talent to hit that high note.
Perhaps he's got short fingers.
Well, every day for 10 years, it's been love in bloom. And now it's a new one. Kiss me once and kiss me twice and da-da-da-da-da. Sorry, dear, but I didn't mean to lose my temper.
Well, cheer up, darling. I'm sure we'll have a lovely evening at Mr. Benny's.
Yeah, I hope so.
Perhaps he'll eat a lot and fall asleep early. Dining room and see the table looks all right.
In a minute, Mary. I'm busy.
Oh, Jack. Jack, you're not going to play your violin tonight.
I am, too. The Colemans are pretty high-class people. They don't go places just to eat. Now, let me track it. I'll have to get a new string.
That was a door buzzer.
Oh, say, maybe that's the... Never mind, Rochester. I'll get it. Yes? Oh, yes, you're the English butler I ordered. Have you had much experience at serving?
Yes,
Well, good. Go right in the kitchen and get started. What's your name?
Butler Flo Wolf.
What was that?
Butler Flo Wolf.
Oh. Well, tonight, I'll just call you Nottingham.
Butler Flo Wolf.
It was the English butler I hired. For tonight, I'm calling him Nottingham. Do you think that's English enough?
Why don't you call him the White Cliffs of Dover?
No, that's too long. Maybe
I'll... Hey, Jackson, why don't you call him Heathcliff?
Heathcliff?
Sure, you're trying to pull a bluff. Oh, filthy, they ought to hang you up instead of your stocking.
You can say that again. Oh, that's Coleman's now.
I'll get it.
No, Rochester, that's why I got the English butler. Nottingham, answer the door, please.
No.
Good evening. Mr. is expecting us.
Oh, come on, come on, sir. I've called the waiting room, the drawing room.
What was that?
Come in, sir. I haven't called the waiting room, the drawing room.
Oh, you're the fellow who sells the tobacco.
I'm glad you came so early.
Hello, Jack, old boy.
So good of you to have us over.
Oh, it's a pleasure indeed. Nottingham, take Mr. and Mrs. Coleman's hat, coat, and canoe. Thank you.
You know, Jack, I just made an awful mistake. I didn't know you had a second butler.
Oh, yes. He's English, you know.
But his English accent is so thick.
Well, he's been there twice. Twice, you know.
Well, if he ever goes back again, he'll choke to death.
Yes. Come, let's go into the drawing room.
By the way, Mr. Benny, where is Manchester?
What? What did you say?
Where is Manchester?
Oh, Manchester. Well, you go out Sepulveda Boulevard.
Jack, Benita means Manchester, your butler.
Oh, that's Rochester. Rochester.
Let Nottingham do it.
I'm not talking to you. Benita, my butler's name is Rochester. He's in the kitchen getting dinner ready. Come, let's go into the drawing room. I want you to meet my associates. Here we are. Mr. and Mrs. Coleman, this is my radio cast. And
How do you do?
How do you do, Mr. and Mrs. Coleman?
Hiya, Ronnie. Benita, what do you hear from the tea and crumpets?
Well, you know, Ronnie, Phil's such an unruly blighter. You should excuse the expression. By the way, Ronnie, I have a little surprise for you this evening. I also invited your friend, Jack Wellington, to dinner.
Wellington, splendid. Did you hear that, Benita?
Yes, isn't that nice?
Sit down, folks. We'll have cocktails in just a few minutes. I hope you'll pardon the way my house looks, but I've been so busy opening mail.
Oh, that reminds me. How is your I Can't Stand Jack Benny radio contest coming along?
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Of course, it ends tomorrow night. So, Benita, if you want to get your letter in, be sure it's postmarked before midnight, December 24th.
You know, Jack just received a citation in Congress because of all the national unity his I Can't Stand Jack Benny contest is promoting.
Was that national unity?
Yes, it's the first time in history that the Republicans and Democrats agree on the same thing.
Yes, sir, that's me. Yep.
Oh, Ronnie, look at that Christmas tree. Isn't it beautiful?
Yes, it certainly is.
I suppose you folks have a nice Christmas tree, too.
Well, we bought a nice tree, but while we were driving home, a peculiar thing happened. Yes, Ronnie made a sharp turn, and that's the last we saw of it.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, how about some cocktails? What would you like, Ronnie?
Oh, nothing right now, thanks, Jack. But after dinner, perhaps a little B&B?
Oh, so will I. For dinner, I always have an S&S.
An S&S. Now, what's that?
Half soda and half sympathy soothing syrup.
Yes, it's awfully good.
Whole meal smooth, Wellington Royal.
What? Oh, he must mean that Wellington is here. Oh, come right in.
Hello, Benny, old boy. Ronnie, Benita.
Wellington.
Mr. Bellis, you are coming.
Mr. Wellington, this is my radio gang here. Miss Mary, all here now.
Hey, Wellington, you lost half your glasses.
Phil, that's a monocle. Half his glasses.
Say, Wellington, I should tell you, we had a letter from Wickersham the other day.
Wickersham? Well, how is the old duffer?
Oh, he sounded cheerful enough. What a sense of humor he has.
Yeah, Willie, that reminds me. Why don't you tell Mr. Benny and his friends that amusing anecdote Wickersham always tells at dinner parties?
Oh, yes. Now, let's see. Now, how does that go?
While you're thinking about it, I can play a solo on my...
Oh, head. I have it.
Good.
Go ahead, ahead, Willie. Tell that amusing story.
Well, it seems that there was a rather old codger in London who was somewhat hard of hearing, and he was riding on a westbound tram towards...
No, Willie. An eastbound tram.
Oh, yes. He was riding on an eastbound tram.
Yeah, he was going to Trafalgar Square, so it must have been a southbound tram.
By Jove, Benita, you're right. It was a southbound tram. Well, anyway, he wanted to get off at Wembley Station.
Now, you see, Jack, Wembley is the station where the tram stops.
Oh, good. I thought the man wanted a jump off.
Well, anyway, this old codger turned to the woman standing next to him and said...
Wasn't it a man standing next to him?
No, it was... By Jove, it's a man.
Anybody here care to shoot a game of pool?
Mary.
Anyway, turned to the man standing next to him and inquired, is this Wembley? And the man said...
No, wait, you forgot to mention that the second chap is hard of hearing, too.
Oh, yes, that's important. Well, he turned to this stranger and asked, is this Wembley? And the stranger who was hard of hearing said, no, isn't Wembley, this is Thursday. So the old codger... I say, did I tell you that this old codger was also hard of hearing?
Oh, yes, you told them that when you mentioned it was a westbound tram.
A southbound.
Oh, yes, Trafalgar Square, that's right.
So the old codger who was hard of hearing said Thursday, so am I. Let's get off and have a drink.
Southbound tram, Trafalgar Square.
Oh, it was a very amusing story, Mr. Wellington. Very funny. Would you folks care for a cigarette?
Yes, thank you.
Southbound tram, Trafalgar Square, Trafalgar...
You see, these cigarettes I just gave you are Lucky Strikes. They're made of the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobacco.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it, now?
He got off at Wembley Station because he was hard of hearing, so he didn't...
And you notice that Lucky Strikes are so round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw.
How enchanting.
Yeah, please go on, Mr. Wilson.
And the second chap got off the tram because it was so fully packed. No, that was a woman, by Jove. That's right.
And that's the reason LSMFT is so popular. LSMFT stands for Lucky Strike means fine tobacco.
Amazing.
Yes, just think of it. LSMFT. Lucky Strike means fine tobacco.
Deucedly clever, isn't it?
So when the stranger said, this is Thursday, the man who was hard of hearing said, so am I. Let's get off and have a drink. Oh, yes, Thursday. Thirsty.
That is a clever anecdote. Yes, sir. Oh, that's a honey. Oh, here come the cocktails. Sit over here, Nottingham.
No.
Well, folks, dinner will be ready pretty soon, and I can't tell you how happy I am that you were all able to come over, particularly at this time, so close to Christmas.
Oh, thank you, Jack.
Oh, thank you.
And since it is so close to Christmas, I think it would be nice if we had Larry Stevens' appropriate song.
Oh, good.
By all means.
Are you ready, Larry?
Yes, Mr. Benny.
Go right ahead. Here, let me sit next to you, Mary.
That was very nice, Larry. Now, folks, let's all have a cocktail before we go into dinner.
Oh, that's fine. And, Jack, if you don't mind, I'd like to propose a toast.
Of course, Ronnie. We'd love to have you do it.
I propose a toast to the world. A world which has just survived the bloodiest and costliest of all human conflicts. A world which was so nearly led back to the dark ages of oppression and slavery by cruel and greedy men who traded in hate. It seems impossible that there could be any more suffering than mankind has just endured. But it is possible, and it will happen, if we lose sight of the lessons so bitterly learned. Let us remember that men everywhere are our neighbors, and their right to life and freedom is as precious to them as ours is to us. So here's a toast to all the people in the world. May we, by working together for a lofty purpose and with God's help, achieve the goal that mankind for 20 centuries has striven for. Peace on earth, goodwill to men.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas,
everybody. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Thanks again to Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman and their friend, Mr. Wellington, for spending the evening with us. And I and my whole gang want to wish everybody everywhere a very Merry Christmas. Good night.
Gentlemen, the contest ends tomorrow, December 24th at midnight. If you haven't sent in your entry, do it now. Just complete this sentence, "I can't stand Jack Benny because," in 50 words or less, and mail your letter to the Jack Benny Contest, Hollywood 28, California. Prizes would total $10,000 in victory bonds, and in case of a duplicate, prizes will be awarded. The board of judges include Goodman Ace of the Easy Aces and Peter Lorre. And the supreme and final judge will be the Honorable Fred Allen. The decision of the judges will be final, and all letters become the property of Jack Benny, including the rights to publish. This contest is open to everyone except the employees of the American Tobacco Company, its agents, and the National Broadcasting Company. It is subject to all federal and state laws and regulations.
This is the National Broadcasting Company. Thank you.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com.
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first